I'm Ken Sinclair of automatedbuildings.com, an online magazine for the industry. I'm very pleased to be in this room and here in Vegas, supplied by AHR Expo. We've got a session for you on the power of people. I have assembled a bunch of industry thought leaders who are going to speak to this subject. I've given them the tough task of rolling their life up and putting it in a 5-minute presentation. So what it's all about is a few years ago, Mark and I started something called the Connection Community Collaboratory. And what we saw is that we're all in the collection community. We basically are collecting data and pulling it together. And we, whether we're in standards groups or various companies, that's basically who we are, and that's what we do, is we basically collect data. The power of the people and the productivity and the satisfaction and the well-being of people is an important product, because we've been basically working at the one-time savings, and we need to be working at the people piece, which is 100 times more significant. And that's why we need to work on exposing the power of the people and also engaging the people to share their power with our industry. So our first speaker is Andy McMillan of BACnet International. And if anybody knows Andy, I've got to see him just speak 5 minutes. So let's go. Andy?
I think my screen goes black, you guys are out of luck. The rest of the stays on, we're good. All right, so not to waste an opportunity, I thought I would talk about three topics in 5 minutes, all related to the topic in general of getting people and the power of people to be effective in what we're trying to do, right, which is lower costs and save energy and make people better and more productive at what they're trying to do. The first topic will be around engagement, what it takes to do that. The second one is around lighting science and what it has to offer us. And the third one is around ethical considerations in doing either one of those. So the first one has behavior change, right? If we're going to have anything different, then someone's behavior has to change, and it's probably not us, right? It's probably the occupants or the users of the space that we're trying to change their behavior. I wouldn't have thought my behavior could be changed by technology, but it turns out it has been. I have a hybrid car because my wife hybrid, so we did. It has this cool little digital dashboard. The darn thing has these little bars that say how you're doing in terms of miles per gallon, and how long you've done over the last, you know, couple of days, and then there's this thing over the last couple of years. And real time, it shows you the power from the electric side and the power from the gas side, because it runs them in parallel. That's sort of the nature of the beast, and it's kind of fun. Get those bars to go where you want them to go, and darned if a couple of years with that car and I'm not actually driving different, and I know it, because I want to make that thing back up to 40 miles over the lifetime, right? 40 miles per gallon for a full size sedan. It's fun. So I have found out that if you coast up the last part of the crown of a hill, you slow down a little bit, but you make it up on the downhill, so the net speed is about the same, but you save energy. You get more miles per gallon. This is a good thing. So I do that now. I've also found out that on the freeway, in this particular car, there's a huge difference between 75 and 65 in terms of gas mileage. So when I'm in a hurry, well, I'll do a little more than 75, but not a lot. But if I'm not in a hurry, I do 65. It's all good. So that technology has changed my behavior, because someone thought about what would a driver be looking at and what would motivate them. So I told some researchers out in California that one time, and they were like, well, sure, because you're an engineer. That works great for you. What does your wife think? And to be fair, my wife could care less about those little gauges and those little bars, and does nothing for her. But but the designers of this car are smarter than me and smarter than the guys in California. They do that too. So they made the dashboard switchable. So she switches the dashboard over to a different display that instead of showing little bars, has this little tree. And you get more leaves if you do better at miles per gallon. And she loves making leaves on that tree. Right? Engaging people is about meeting them where they are in terms of how they interact with technology. And when we do that better, we'll get people more successfully engaged in the behaviors we're trying to change them to. That's the first thing. The second thing, this is a huge passion. I could talk about this for hours, but I promise not to. Okay. And that's the power of lighting science to change behavior. Right? Most of us know spending a week in Seattle at one of its cloudy times, for most of us, is just not the same as spending a week in Phoenix, when it's not 104, of course, but when it's sunny. Right? That light affects us. It turns out light affects us in a lot of ways. Intensity, color temperature, absolute color, those things matter, and people know it. I worked at Philips Lighting and went in their experimental lab, and they have a way of changing the lighting in the context to make it very clear to you that lighting affects behavior. So people know that, and they even know how it does it. It's never been translated large scale into buildings because it's been very expensive to have light that changes color and intensity real time. It's not expensive anymore. And over the next few years, it's going to get much less expensive because LEDs do that much simpler. So using LEDs and controls and lighting science to impact the behavior we're trying to get is going to be huge. I think those dollars are going to swamp the energy dollars in terms of value added to a building. Philips has data that proves you can go home from a hospital earlier if you put the right lighting in the recovery rooms. Real data. They have real systems they sell in Germany that demonstrably improve educational outcomes. These are huge values, way bigger than saving energy. And we've just begun to tap them because it's just become cost-effective to have lighting that changes in both color and intensity at relatively low cost. I think that's going to be huge for getting people engaged and for making the space more responsive so they can be more successful at whatever they're doing in the space. Okay, now for the third topic, because I'm going to stop with that even though I want to keep going. Inherently, what we're trying to do with this is indirectly change people's behavior. Right? We're trying to do things around them that affect what they do. That sounds an awful lot like manipulation. So one has to ask, what are the ethical considerations of manipulation? How far can we go? What can we do? What should we not do? And I have zero answers around that question, just the question. But it seems like we ought to ask it, because it's not any different than any other domain in which we try to affect people's behavior. For example, how many of you have something to do with sales? Any kind of context of sales effect? A bunch of you, all right? So I suspect some of you have done things specifically to influence buying behavior. Right? You've probably done something like an assumptive close. Because you know an assumptive close helps to get the buyer to say yes rather than think about it some more. It's a good thing. No one would argue that's unethical. On the other hand, if you leave something out that the customer needs to know because they didn't think to ask about it, and it would have made your sale tougher or not doable, that might be unethical. Yeah, you've affected their behavior, but maybe not in an ethical way. We've been doing this all for lots and lots of years, so people have a sense of what's ethical and what's not in sales. I don't think we have a clue what's ethical and what's not in getting the building, an environment, to affect people's behavior. It's about time we're going to have to think about it.
Thank you very much, Andy. That's a great opener to our topic. And John, you want to jump right in and tell us how we have to define some of these pieces of our puzzle.
All right. Well, I'll start on the people topic. I hate following people like Andy down the highway. He's more concerned with the leaves on his dashboard than he is getting out of my way so I can get down the highway. I specifically detest people like that. The highway is not a place to save energy. It's a place to get through. So anyways. All right, I'm here, I'll speak today from my role in an open standards organization called Project Haystack. And it relates, I'll focus my comments around productivity because it affects all of these other topics. We have wonderful technology out on the floor, all of us here, and one of the challenges is how do you get people to adopt it, to commit without unscrupulously manipulating them. cost is a factor, right? How much does it cost to make this wonderful thing work for me? And in the area of data and data-driven technologies, the ability to get data out of our systems, to be able to use that data, analyze that data, provide valuable actionable information back to people, there are some challenges. And one of the key challenges is that the data that comes from all these wonderful sensors and devices and control systems out there is very messy. It is not uniformly described or named or formatted, etc. So if I have a wonderful technology and I want to bring together data from these different systems, the first step is a very painful, expensive, manual process. Understanding the data, mapping the data, tagging the data, wrangling the data, there's a lot of different names out there for it. As we try to integrate more and more different systems and technologies, this becomes a huge challenge to getting the value of the solution in front of the customer. In fact, I think, Paul, you're aware of this, that a consultant, after seeing the wonderful benefits that analytics software can deliver, decided to do a little bit of study to understand why does it cost so much to implement these. And they determined that 70% of the engineering cost was going into this black hole, which was interpreting, mapping, wrangling, tagging the data. Okay, so in 2011, a bunch of us in the industry who would like to see our technology get adopted saw that this is a industry-wide problem. It's not really a commercial problem, it's something that needs to change. So we got together and we formed an open source initiative called Project Haystack, project-haystack.org, if you're not familiar with it. And it's completely open source, volunteer-based, and we came together around an effort to create a standardized methodology and approach to defining the meaning of data. It is not a, if you've heard about it, it is not a standard naming convention. We are not telling you how to name the points in your BAS. It's a markup language. Now, I'll make the analogy this way. We all use the web, right? We all pull up a browser. I can pull up Firefox, Safari, Chrome, IE, whatever. And I go to a website and I get the results. And the reason for that is long ago, that industry agreed on a markup language. You will define your web pages this way with these tags. You can put anything you want on that web page, but you use this markup language so it'll be universally interpretable. It's like, yeah, duh, obviously. How else would the web work? We don't have a similar markup language, or we didn't, for the data that comes out of systems and devices. And that's a big challenge that is holding back the adoption of a lot of technologies. And this ties to the productivity. If we can solve that problem, the productivity of all of us who deliver solutions to building owners increases. Their cost goes down, not because we don't make any money, but because it's easier, it's better, it's faster, cheaper. And that's what Project Haystack does. So that a community of people came together, tie into one of the themes, to address a problem, to improve productivity, another theme, and develop an open source community that works together to solve these challenges called projecthaystack.org. So that's, you know, kind of the perspective I want to offer on this, because as we look at how we're going to make buildings more efficient, more comfortable, more satisfying, this is part of it. There's great technologies that can help, but if the effort to implement them outweighs the visible or definable value, it gets held back. And other than that, Andy, I am going to turn on my headlights and flash them. Please get out on it.
I think we're all starting to see the flavor of this community.
Yeah.
This is going to be a bit of browsing back and forth. Next, Mark Petock is going to follow up John. And good job, John. Thanks.
I'm kind of going against John. Sorry, pal. All right. So lately, in our industry, there are three letters, in my opinion, that have completely changing the way we behave, the way we tell customers how what our technology is supposed to do, their expectations. Anybody guess what those three letters are? Thank you. Thank you from the back. Thank you. IoT. All right, so we've heard this for years. The 50 billion devices, whatever. It's not the number of devices. That's the difference between things on the internet and the internet of things. So as this whole concept is taking our space, behavior-wise, it's caused the technology providers to completely change the way they look at things, and this is in a positive way. Building owners, their expectations have completely changed. So from that perspective, behaviors, both sides, the occupants, the building owners, and the technology providers are changing. Now, with this world of IoT, there are 425 platforms out there. There are over 126 standards. Now, how is that going to change, or how is it changing behaviors? How is it changing process? To me, with all those types of standards out there, it will never change. Further, in looking at from the perspective from the IoT side, is a new concept, new value propositions, I think, from the technology side, is the people productivity within a building. And I see day after day after day that it's important for the occupants to feel safe, comfortable. Yes, we've been saying that for years as an industry. And I've questioned, is by having an average temperature in a building, the right light, truly going to change the productivity level of an individual that much versus, oh, it's the greatest thing since sliced bread, and if it doesn't, they're going to improve their productivity by 100%. I have yet to see that research, and I think I'm probably one of the only folks out there that has not gone to that side of the house as far as the productivity in a building, that is the greatest thing. So that's how I see these three letters completely changing our industry from productivity, from behavior, from all aspects. So thanks.
Okay, now we've got Paul Oswald from ESI, Global Workspace Solutions. That's a big title, so he's solving the world for us.
Yeah, as part of CBRE, everything has a big title, but I don't have any specific agenda. These are going to be some not so random comments and opinions about what I think our industry needs to be looking at over the next 3, 5, 7, 10 years. Number one, we have a lot of technology. IoT, big data, analytics, all great stuff. But if we don't start fixing the equipment in the buildings, it's not going to get us very far. We talk about making buildings perform better, about boosting productivity. Can't do it until we start fixing the equipment. The deferred maintenance backlog in most organizations is through the roof. And somewhere we got to start tackling that problem without thinking that just piling on more technology is going to solve it. It just doesn't add up. Second, with regard to productivity, I don't think we can improve people's productivity. I think that is taking on a challenge that's way too broad and way beyond our industry. But what we can do, what we have a responsibility to do, is make sure that the buildings people work in don't detract from their productivity. That, I think, is something we're responsible for. And Andy mentioned earlier that this requires change. And unless I misunderstood, I think he was focusing on change of the people working in the buildings. I disagree with that. I agree with the change piece, but change is around every one of us. It's on top of every one of us. We have to change the way we think about managing and operating buildings. We have to change the way we think about designing and constructing buildings. We've got to change the way we think about applying technology in buildings. There's all kinds of solutions at our disposal. More come online every day. But there's also a massive amount of hype and missed expectations around a lot of that. That unless we start changing our thinking, unless we start changing behaviors, and by the way, that includes changing the behaviors of people who buy this stuff, we're not going to get to truly better performing buildings that enhance or do not detract from people's productivity. And the final point is, and again this goes to the productivity issue, most of what we do day in and day out is focused on the energy save. From where we sit, energy savings is a 1x problem. By that I mean it's a single digit, a single dollar per square foot issue. Whereas lease cost, operating and maintenance cost is a 10x issue. but the employees in your building are a 100x issue. Let's go figure out which problem we're really trying to solve. Thanks.
Well, that's great. Our next speaker, Neil Cannon from Notion, is going to tell us about the wireless play on all of this. Neil?
That's a tall order, but I'll give it a shot. So first of all, I'd like to comment that I think I passed John and Andy on the way here on the highway. I do have a house festooned in solar panels to make up for the guilt. So that said, I'm probably the most egregious carbon dioxide emitter from automobiles in the room. I just say that up front. But I am very interested in saving energy inside of buildings, and some of the issues that some of the other talented speakers brought up, I think we can address with technology. I think I'm an optimist for technology. I'm a proponent for technology. I've made all of the money that bought me all these cars that allowed me to pass you guys, and is from technology. So it seems to me that technology can bring a lot to bear. It's just not visible yet. When you picked up the first cell phone, you didn't think that was such an impressive item. When you pick up today's cell phone, that's a pretty darn impressive item. You got to let the engineers have a little time to work, and they usually figure out a lot better schemes than were first envisioned. And they solve more problems, not fewer, when they come up with innovations. We can't forget that. Some of the issues of maintenance, some of the issues of productivity aren't actually even fully visible yet. They're not actually we're not actually aware of what all of the technologies will do to the buildings once we get them installed. That's why it's so important to get early adopters. Once you get early adopters, they show the light to the rest of the world. They show the ability to take technology and move the mark. And once you see that mark move, you want to go to that mark. When you see your neighbor who has a better technology than you, or your coworker who has got a newer laptop even, or a newer iPad, they're doing something faster, better, easier than you, you generally catch up. I think that's what's going to happen. Now, I agree that the wireless piece of this at the moment is a little confusing. There's a lot of standards out there. There's Bluetooth, there's Zigbee, there's Notion, actually. There's a lot of things that have been tried that I could go down a long list that aren't necessarily going to change much of the world. And it is important to get to standards. But as I was telling Ken, I worked in the fiber optics industry for a good portion of my career. And what the consumer actually eventually saw from fiber optics is very, very high speed connection. They didn't know that when you picked up your phone and called Europe, you changed protocols 4 or 5 times. That digital concept went all the way through that fiber, changing. Clever engineers were figuring out how to get it from one protocol to another, not miss a beat. There was very little hesitation in the calls, even after a while. Remember, we used to have these delays and stuff. That all kind of got addressed. And this was done by engineering, it was done by technology. I do believe that there'll be some winnowing out, and there'll be some benefits to fewer wireless standards, and there'll be some benefits to things being, let's say, cheaper because they can all be mass produced on one type of protocol. That said, I don't think it's absolutely obligatory because buildings are fixed locations. Once you have the information out of that building brought up to the cloud, you're pretty much good. So one thing Notion is doing, we're working with IBM Watson. Why are we doing that? Well, IBM Watson wants to get information out of buildings. And why do they want to get information out of buildings? Because they think they can do a better job with analytics. They can offer value to people that people don't even see today. I was just at CES with the IBM people, and they have tons of future think going on. They've got a number of things. They want you to be shaving in the morning and doing your work at the same time, and asking questions of your IBM Watson know-it-all machine. But there's also some very concrete things, just space optimization, just how facilities are used, that they can bring Watson to bear. Watson can make intuitive decisions rather than just command-based decisions. A command-based decision is when you say, turn the light on. The other kind of thing is, well, what level should the lights be at for the time of day? What should it be for the weather outside? What should it be, some of the color-changing things that were mentioned earlier? All of this stuff can be built into Watson. And Notion is working with them because the last 100 feet of the network is pretty darn tough. And IBM realizes that. The last 100 feet of anything gets to be harder and harder. In fiber optics, it was the last mile. We couldn't dig up the yards and go through the shrubs because somebody was going to get upset about that. But the last 100 feet is very tough. And you basically, in wireless, you have two options. You can either use a wired sensor or a wired wireless node, which kind of gives you all the problems of having to tear the building apart, or you can use a battery, and you can put a battery in a building to send information back. There's finally a third option, which I'm calling power from the people, as opposed to the people, which, you know, it's InOcean's technology. It's a very simple little switch device. This sends a radio signal. In fact, maybe I just updated something to Watson just there. that doesn't require any battery. It doesn't require any wire, because it can use that little click, that little energy that I gave it, to provide that signal. Or you can use solar cells to do a similar job. This, I think, is very promising. It means that you can put sensors throughout a building. You can get a lot of information uploaded to the cloud without a high overhead, either in terms of running wires or maintaining batteries. As our friend from CBRE just mentioned, there isn't much room left for adding to the maintenance budget. In fact, the maintenance budget is a backlog in most places. I agree with you 100%. So adding more things that require maintenance is not a good idea. But I do think this kind of technology, and as I said again, I'm a big proponent of technology. Technology can change things in ways we can't see, but once we get it started, it will show us the way. It'll show us the way more than we know now. We don't want to assume the answer, we want to learn the answer. That's my answer.
Thank you very much, and great play on how we get from field to self-learning databases, which that link. Now, another piece I wanted to bring up is the merging of technologies. I think traditionally the bulk of us in this room are from the building automation industry, and of course we have this new phenomenon of the lighting industry and LED technology, which is radically changing how lighting is deployed in the building, and as well as to that human satisfaction piece has a lot to do with lighting. And I was really pleased to Trevor, and I've known each other since ever. And he comes from the control side, and he's crossed over. So I want to hear his take on the lighting industry. Trevor,
thanks.
Problem.
Thanks very much.
Distech Acuity.
So Distech Acuity. So let me just say, gentlemen, that I've never felt like an old guy. And then I look at my son, who's just turning 12 years old, and I'm realizing that I'm getting a little older. So I remember back when I joined the industry, I guess it was about 18 probably, when I first talked to you, Ken. I was in the contracting business, and I was a systems integrator. And actually, when I first started in the industry, I started pulling pneumatic tubes around a building. And we actually weren't selling really energy management equipment, or we weren't really selling these great network systems. We were selling comfort control systems. Right? Everybody remember that? We were out there selling comfort control systems. And that quickly drifted on to energy management with the advent of these more advanced proprietary digital networks in the building. And so it became a little bit more sophisticated. We could do a little bit more heavy lifting. Now we could keep people comfortable in a building. And we could also demonstrate energy savings, which was really quite interesting. I'll drift back to my son just for a second. So, We moved back from England a little while ago, and my son found a box full of cassette tapes. Most of you in the room, I hope all of you know what a cassette tape is. My son was very bewildered by this. So he picked up the cassette tape and looked at me and said, "Dad, what's this?" I said, "Well, that's a cassette tape." He said, "Well, what do you do with it?" "Well, you listen to music on it." And he said, "Well, what was the machine you would load this in?" "Well, it was..." I said, "Never mind, just go to your room." "Go to your room, I'm aggravated." And of course, we don't use cassette tapes anymore because there was the advent of the DVD, right? The CD-ROM, finally the DVD. And then this strange thing called the MP4 player. Apple made it pervasive, right, with the iPod. So my son has only grown up in that environment, right? So what do you think his expectations are from a facility? Do you think they're different than they were before? Of course they're different. Or else we'd still be running pneumatic tubes through facilities, right? He's got a smartphone. He's 12 years old. He's got a smartphone. He connects to me not by calling, but by texting or using WhatsApp, right? He's going to want to connect with his business environment eventually when he graduates from college and go to a building that he enables him to personalize and connect with his business space the same way he's connecting to me by text. It's a vast change in a relatively short period of time. Right? And this technology hasn't been around for that long. So let's get back to lighting. I joined Haystack Controls in 2013. We were sold to Acuity Brands. Very exciting, very bold move from an Acuity perspective. They are deadly serious about bringing together building management systems with lighting. Why is that? If you look out, how many lights do you see in this room? Lots, right? And as we convert all these lighting systems from traditional ballasts and fluorescents that are just connected to power and convert them to LEDs, guess what drives each one of these LEDs? There's a microprocessor on board. So all of a sudden, you've, in effect, within every lighting fixture, you've got a mini computer. You can do a lot more heavy lifting with that. You can turn that into a communication network. You can condition the light, as Andy was muting earlier, to make people feel more comfortable or condition health. And you can even tie it back into your building management system. So just a really quick example of what we can do that's relatively simple. By connecting those two domains, you can actually change the color temperature of the light to make you feel actually warmer or cooler in the space without doing anything to the mechanical system. That's an energy savings. Then if you talk about some of the other things you can do, there are technologies that exist that allow you to allow a smartphone camera to basically see each one of these light fixtures as a barcode. That's useful information when you upload it to a cloud and you have a physical overlay of a facility. You can actually follow a phone around very, very accurately. You can apply those in different vertical markets. You can apply those in an airport to give you indoor mapping, facility to guide you from where you've arrived at your flight to your next gate, and oh, by the way, tell you at the same time how long your lineup is at Starbucks when you're stopping off to get a coffee. Those are the types of things these new systems are enabling us to do, right? And those are not necessarily just tackling the first digit, the running operating costs that Paul was muting, or making the asset itself more valuable, the income that these building owners are getting, but it's actually really making the building a more pleasant and interactive place to be in. That's what these new systems are enabling us to do. So, thank you very much.
As you can see, there are a lot of changes in the air. Now, you have a unique opportunity here, an amazing opportunity to ask questions of these industry thought leaders. So I'm going to ask them to take a seat up here.
Yeah, David Butler with HDR Consulting. So Andy, I'd like you to expand a little bit on your comment about ethics. And I'm going to preface that by saying that last week I organized a session with a neuroscientist speaking about human-centric lighting. So I know a little bit about the topic and some of the discussions around the ability to control lighting and provide stimulation in a space. I will say that when it comes to energy, human-centric lighting gets to be very, very interesting because when we really apply human-centric lighting to the built environment, the energy savings become even greater than when we simply apply controls. That said, we do have to apply ethics and the way that we use it responsibly, because there already have been complaints in the market about using lighting to manipulate people. So I'd like you to, I guess my question is, the degree to which you see medical science coming into the built environment to help us decide on the best approach towards applying human-centric lighting.
Definitely yes, absolutely. I guess from my perspective, when I talk about the science of light, what I mean is the way light interacts with our biology to affect us. And maybe that's the same thing as the neuroscience approach, although they're looking more maybe just at a part of that. But the end of all that is, from my perspective, to achieve an outcome that whatever the designer thinks is desirable. Right, that's the goal. In healthcare, if the design goal is to get people better faster, it's hard to argue any ethics there. I mean, that's what they're there to do. You move to the retail space, right? It turns out that if you use LED lighting in the fruit section, you actually save a bunch of money as a retailer because the fruit doesn't dehydrate as fast and you sell it by the pound. So on average, you make extra revenue from that same fruit you were selling before. Seems perfectly ethical. They're getting fruit that's still got all the water in it. Life is good. Well, you can also manage the lighting so as to affect people's urge to purchase, or at least people believe you can. I haven't seen that research, but it turns out people buy more at dusk. And it's not because they're coming home from work. They buy more at dusk for some other not so obvious reasons. So if you make a dusk happen in your store around lunchtime when lots of people are in the store, maybe they'll buy more. If that's true, would that be ethical? I don't know the answer, but clearly they're very different questions depending on what you're trying to get people to do, whether it's ethical to manipulate them without them knowing it. I don't claim to have any answers about that, but I think there are questions that we're going to have to figure out the answers to if light is as impactful as I think it is.
Trevor, do you want to weigh in on that at all?
I sure can. I mean, at Acuity, we're doing an awful lot of work associated with tunable white. And tunable white really designed for the K-12 vertical. So we're trying to create environments that are more or less more pleasant to work in, either energizing kids in a classroom or calming them down by just manipulating the light. You know, I think you bring up an interesting point. You know, is that an ethical thing, or are you actually meeting a design requirement of the facility? I'm not quite sure.
I'm not either.
Yeah.
I like the one about education, though, because I did some of that with Phillips, and the idea that you can reduce distractions in the classroom seems like a good thing.
Yeah, so in Paris, in one of the projects that that I've been involved in, so in Paris and La Défense, they have in the subway stations actually the example of the light effect on actually the way you're feeling. So rather than turning on mechanical heating to heat the space or cooling, actually what they're doing is they're just changing the color of the white to actually make you feel warmer or cooler. I didn't actually notice it until somebody pointed it out to me just as a rider of Metro. So
it was actually a school where parents, when they found out that the teachers had been using tunable lighting to calm the students, objected and felt that that the students were being manipulated by the teachers. And that's where I think we need to be having these conversations about ethics that may expand beyond what we originally thought. I mean, we may be talking about how temperature control affects our interaction with spaces and what is responsible and what isn't. Like Andy, I don't have an answer today, but I think it's something that we need to be talking about quite seriously as the opportunity for very detailed, very precise control of the built environment comes into play.
Three of you who have been talking about it, who owns the responsibility to start those conversations and make them part of everyday conversation? Is it the manufacturer? Is it the school district? Is it the consumer? Is it who?
I vote him. Everybody in
favor? Thanks.
I would argue that every form of lighting they've talked about is better than what it replaces. Actually, once you get fluorescent lighting out of buildings, you arrest a lot of bad things that, mm-hmm. that were happening to people otherwise. Mm-hmm. Buzzing noises that influenced children. I was in the lighting in the LED business myself. And we retrofitted an entire school just to get rid of the ballast that was disturbing the children that had certain types of neurological disorders. Mm-hmm. And I would say they're actually working towards making the world a much easier, better place mm-hmm. to navigate. I'd like to see us have CO2 in all the schools as well, because the Harvard School of Public Health came out and said pretty clearly below about, or after about 800 ppm CO2, you've got half your cognitive power, which might be affecting this room right now.
It would appear to be, actually.
But it's true.
It's intensely affecting this room.
Yeah, indeed. But the reality is that when we give students tests, we're deciding something about how their life is going to be from that point forward. Why not give them the best lighting, the best ventilation, the best comfort you can possibly give them, and make that standard? I think that should be a goal.
But what is best? The parents apparently don't agree with you that...
Indeed, yeah. I mean,
what is best
has to be explained to people. Improvement is made, it's not obvious that it doesn't have other implications.
Absolutely.
But if you look at the negative implications of what you're taking out, I think most people would agree that your two companies are on the right path.
The other thing is, I like to every time we come into kind of a conversation about, you know, kind of ethics or what is this new technology providing that somebody needs to either opt in or get used to hearing about or agree with or whatever you're going to do. In the case of schools, Schools are there to provide the best possible test outcomes and educate children, right? And if so, if these technologies we're introducing, whether it's tying CO2 in a demand control ventilation scheme to maintain, you know, appropriate levels of CO2 in the space, or creating the perfect lighting ambient environment for pupils to learn, I think we're getting back to where we should be with buildings, which is we're actually remembering the purpose of why we're building the building, and less about get in, get out, and get your money on the job. So we're going, I think, in the right direction. Now, that being said, some of these new IoT connected devices will provide everything from convenient to creepy, right? So you know, and I'll give you an example. If we're tracking movements of individuals around a store, somebody has to opt into that, right? Somebody has to opt in to share that data, right? We don't know where that individual is, but it's kind of creepy to think, well, we could know, right? So that's the creepy part. The convenient part is when I'm going around and enjoying a shopping experience, I can find something very easily on my mobile device and get guided directly to it. That's the convenient aspect. So I think there are good stories with all of these technologies, and I think getting people used to them and the development of them are accelerating. Getting people used to them, the mere fact that we're having conversations like this, is what's going to prompt the change.
Great. Actually, I think this is also a great introduction into the other measured variables that I'm looking for, which is satisfaction and productivity. And I'm guessing they're going to have the same kinds of issues, is that as we try to capture some of that data, we're going to capture you know, some of the others. Is there any, Brad, do you want to jump in on that?
Yeah, I think I just wanted to add maybe another layer to the ethical complexity here, especially since we're talking about schools. You think, well, you know, the schools that can afford this technology are maybe in a wealthy suburb, and you know, the inner city schools with poorer funding can't afford the new LED lighting and the IoT devices and the tunable things to optimize learning conditions. So, you know, there's a further ethical consideration here, I think, and you know, are we further exacerbating the, you know, disparity in outcome, educational outcomes? So, yeah, not to say I have any answers to that, but you know, it's another layer to the ethical conundrum here.
Digital lighting divide.
There's good news and bad news to this, right? The bad news is, of course, when we implement that, where we implement the technology first is going to be driven by economics, right? It's going to be economically driven. The great news is, actually, when you're changing luminaires, the payback, the energy saving payback, is so great it doesn't matter where you apply it, right? And once you apply it once, that savings is going to be there forever. And once you've got LEDs in the facility, you have an infrastructure that you can add on these other services to, right? It's an internal part of the technology. So,
great. Any other questions? Sharish, you got a question?
Yeah, another comment is, and I'm thinking about everything Paul Oswald's already said at this conference and at previous conferences. One is about scope. Is this topic really within the scope? I happen to be walking my daughter around various schools and interior design schools from out of Chicago, Chicago School of the Art Institute, who is one of the biggest education facilities for interior design, and they had a whole floor full of lighting differences, different LEDs. I can see that really being in their scope, and I was very encouraged to see School of the Art Institute training their new students. But ghost of Paul a few years ago, the people aren't there, you know, the people being trained like this aren't here yet. The technology is running so much faster than we have graduated people that know how to put this out in an ethical, best human factor design way.
I'd like to pose a question to the panel is, how can we quantify productivity, satisfaction, well-being? How can we reach out? The lighting is starting to become a big piece of that, but how can we start to roll that up? Does anybody want to speak to that? How can we do that? How Paul, how do you figure out globally in all your workspace how satisfied your folks are?
We discussed this yesterday. Measuring productivity is a swamp. There's very little hard quantitative data that you can point to show direct productivity improvement. I'll give you an example. We process millions of work orders every day, every year. 61% of those are hot-cold complaints. As I said in the session yesterday, I can't directly correlate a hot-cold complaint to productivity, but it doesn't take a big stretch of the imagination to know that for all the time that the occupant is notifying facilities or engineering or sending a text or an email saying they're too hot or too cold, or is spending time running for the nearest space heater or fan, that's time they're not working on productive stuff. Is there a direct correlation there that I can say with certainty that's a productivity killer? No. But you can make some general inferences around that to say it's likely. So maybe we don't overthink the problem. Maybe job one is, if we know that hot-cold is the majority of building occupants' complaint, maybe we start there. And let's start addressing, reducing that, and seeing what that does. But today, you know, in our own building, we have what has been considered a very intelligent building. But even within that, and within a relatively small base of employees, we can't get at medical information to understand why somebody was sick. Was it a result of an airborne thing? Was it a result of some interior environmental condition? There's no way you go back to the ethics thing. We don't have access to that kind of detail to prove in a very hard quantitative way what's driving productivity.
It was a building that was built maybe 5 years ago, maybe a little less. So all the latest technologies were kind of applied within this facility. And we were having a struggle with, or human resources were having a struggle with kind of getting feedback from, general feedback from employees. So we went out on the market and we got basically a cloud-based tool that everybody would sign up to, and it would pose on a weekly basis certain questions. So, you know, everything to, I shamefully answered a lot of these. Have you eaten breakfast this morning? My answer was always no. What's, you know, do you get exercise? How are you feeling today? Is your space, you know, comfortable? Things like that. And this tool would actually compile results and give you an output of here's how much absenteeism you would expect from your particular type of facility based on the responses to the questions. And then you'd match that with how many absentees you'd actually have. And they were, I thought it was a load at the beginning, and I actually looked at it, and it was fairly accurate. So there's some companies that are out there that are focused, and I won't mention them in the context of this meeting, but there's some of them that are focused on actually getting direct employee feedback in the context of some of the improvements they're making within the office space, which is, you know, one of the ways to improve, I suppose. But it's soft.
There were some companies that will tell you that for every survey you ask an employee to take, you're taking away from productivity.
Exactly.
One other thing, I think when we talk about productivity, back to your point, the building has a purpose. And productivity needs to be measured in the context of the purpose. Mm-hmm. An office building, that's a tough measure.
Yeah.
Schools, it's actually an easy measure if you accept educational outcomes as the measure. Mm-hmm. Hospitals are pretty easy that way. If you measure, we've got a lot of metrics now on medical outcomes and patient satisfaction, actually. Those are
Retail's an easy one.
Retail's an easy one. Office space is a tough one.
Patient satisfaction, that sounds interesting.
There's a lot of patient satisfaction stuff going on now because hospitals are competing. Direct patient survey.
Okay.
Yeah, tell me what you didn't like about your stay is almost the norm now.
And they've turned that into marketing.
Yes.
That my hospital rated 100% satisfaction or over the last 30 yeah. days in our ER or whatever. So they're taking that power of the data, the analytics, and then turning it into that experience and, you know, and why we're different.
And who's driving that? Human resources?
No, marketing and the hospital administration. Because so, as to Andy's point, yeah. every hospital right now is under so much competition
to get bodies into their hospital.
And then get them out.
And get them out.
Because they don't make money if they stay there.
No, exactly, exactly. Good point, good point.
Suggests to me that that's an industry that, or a group that we should be talking to as an industry to point out some of the stuff that you're talking about, Paul, is if the systems are not working and got 2x4s in them, that is definitely a message that has to go there and it has to somehow get into their surveys. Maybe we have to start figuring out a way that we as an industry can participate in some of that well-being analysis, because I think we are a big part of it. We're a big part of it. Lighting, we're a big part of it. Temperature, comfort.
Back to the knowledge and stuff. So I live in Richmond, Virginia, and you're driving down the interstate. There are two billboards or outdoor boards. Two competing hospital. Emergency room wait 7 minutes, emergency room 20 minutes. You're driving, you need an emergency, where are you gonna go? 7 minutes, not 20 minutes.
Well, they all used to be an hour and a half.
Yeah, no, exactly.
But they're down to that time because they suddenly were faced with a public 20 minutes
right,
over
right.
here, 2 hours over there. Right. Well, right. How do they get to 20? Well, we're going there. We're doing better than 20. So that public information is incredibly powerful.
Or
and
then
there are other places to get public
information. Yeah, or transportation. You're driving down Interstate 64 in Virginia, and you want to go to Virginia Beach from the west going toward the east. Two ways. Electronically, every X amount of miles, 36 minutes to go this way, 55 minutes. Where are you going to go? You're changing behavior.
Maybe your survey is kind of going to manage.
Oh, I was going to say, John or Andy. Yeah, John, you know, 15 minutes. Trust me, I've driven with him, so, you know.
That would affect things. Yeah.
Actually, what came out of one of our other sessions was the value of social media, and I'd like each one of you to, or any of you to take a take on that. But one of the points that Paul pointed out is that we shouldn't just listen to social media. We should be social media. We should basically create our message and send it out. And that's sort of something as an industry I don't think we have really done at all, and I think we need to learn how to do a better job of that. First of all, I think we have to develop social media vehicles for each of our buildings, try and get them to use. I don't think it's necessary that we have 100% buy-in, whether it's a unique system for that building. But this whole idea of getting our message out as to whether just the things we're doing, that we are improving the lighting, we are actually making the maintenance, we are fixing some of those problems. If we've got 100 problems, that we fixed 20 problems this week. Yay, you know, at least.
But does that take away from productivity? To Paul's question.
Oh, I see.
Earlier, that, oh, I'm too busy looking at the social media to say, oh, well, there were 350 complaints in the building. Oh, well, now we're down to 225. Great. Hey, John, do you know they're down to 225?
Yeah, but at least they're looking at our social media.
Yeah, no, I know. Exactly, exactly.
I think it was in the context of just applying some fundamental customer service principles to facility operation and maintenance. So let's go back to the hot-cold complaint. In a perfect world, the system would be self-healing, and absolutely, you'd never have a hot-cold complaint, right? But that's a perfect world.
Get perfect people, too, because
perfect
people next to each other don't want the same temperature.
That's exactly right. So now the person registers the complaint hot-cold, and the facilities team looks at this thing and they say, you know what, I see the problem, I don't have the part to fix that problem, it's not a simple set point or adjustment or anything like that. So there, social media could be used to push the information back out to the person making the request to say, we're working on it. Got the problem, know that we're working on it, because ask yourself, what's the one thing when you're having a problem, whether it's getting on a plane, renting a car, going to a restaurant, whatever it is, you want to be kept informed, right? Makes the problem, doesn't take away the problem, but it makes the problem seem a little easier if you know what's going on.
Yes, sir. Hi, my name is Cliff Swain. I'm with C3 Engineering in Edmonton, Canada. I got a question for John. Hi, John. I've been involved in building automation most of my life, and I know there's a lot of data, trend logs, different point monitoring and so forth. What exactly are you doing with all this data to make it more people friendly? I don't quite understand what you're focusing on here. If you could explain a little better.
Sure, I'll try. So I'll speak in the context of the effort of Project Haystack.
and what they're doing? Is that your question, or are you talking about how data analytics can help?
All this data that you're gathering.
Okay, so on the commercial side of what I do, we make analytics software. And it takes in data from systems and automatically identifies patterns that indicate there's faults, there's deviations, there's trends, there's anomalies. Here's what's important in your data so you don't have to go through it manually. Because there's too much data to go through it manually. So if I can tell you the VAV, the pitot-tube sensor on that VAV fan is not registering, so you're never getting modulation of the fan and getting any benefit out of that $6,000 VFD you put in. Would you like to be told that? All right? If you're a building operator or owner. That's what data analytics can do for people. And it's really, it comes down to many simple things that if we had an infinite team of people in the building, you'd find that. But you know, that's, if you've been doing this for a while, you know that's not the case. Mm-hmm. These things happen, they go unnoticed, right? And they run for a period of time and they may affect comfort, satisfaction, certainly energy. When you take the data in, now software tools can automatically find these patterns and issues and behaviors and trends in the data.
So how are you picking up all this data? Are you actually going on site?
No, you connect to systems. If they've got a relatively modern BAS, you connect to it over BACnet or OBIX, or maybe it's already in a SQL database on the front end, or maybe you import energy interval meter data and CSV files from the last year, and now you can look at the trends and performance of your building and benchmark it against other facilities.
I see.
So the information, that there is valuable information in the data. The problem is that manually there's too much friction and effort to find it. Now software tools have advanced to the level that give the software the data, it'll tell you the things that matter in the data.
And the technology is advancing very rapidly where you don't need to necessarily go in, have a BMS or go in there. There's edge devices out there that are inexpensive that basically can port that data up to the analytics, you know, and things like that. So.
Hi, I am Ankur from GCI. My question is with respect to starting from the Haystack, which is about tagging. The things are more complicated than tagging when we talk about, if we take it to the next level, that how to message that tags, how the communication can be optimized. Then I listened about that BACnet is moving towards BACnet IP to BACnet IT, where the security will also come into the picture. Now these things which are working in bits and pieces, again, will this not create the same complexity what we have talked about, like IoT with 276 different platforms and everything? Because still, like, things are so diverse that we solve one problem and create four others.
Panacea that solves all the problems, but we're chipping away at the problems. So we had, first of all, you know, we had systems that wouldn't talk to each other, and then we had standard protocols. So now you can connect. Is it still a bunch of work to connect? Yeah. But is it better? It's way better. Now we've reached the point, well, the data contained in there should be self-describing so that I can quickly interpret it or hand it off to a valuable application like analytics. Virtually every communication standard in the world, the BACnet group, the OBIX group, the Haystack group, has realized the way you accomplish this is with semantic tagging. Okay? There may be different approaches. There's actually a lot of commonality. BACnet has to do it a different way because they have a protocol that requires you to fit within that. Right? What the Haystack group has done is come up with a methodology that can be carried on virtually any communication protocol, and so that it will minimize the differentiation and minimize the work. But it dramatically simplifies it. It's not in this session, but in other sessions you can see the engineering involved in implementing a BAS system, if you tag the data, can be reduced almost 10 to 1. Okay? So it didn't go to zero. Agreed. It went 10 to 1 though. That's incremental progress, which is the foundation of civilization, right?
One might argue it's more than incremental, even.
I came from Brazil. Congratulations for this panel. So important.
Oh, thank you.
Because technology goes so fast, and quality of life normally not so fast. So I would like to know if you have a chance to take this money back to the tenants when the building is sick, for example, with a lot of this side effects in performance of the employees, etc.
So to use analytics to gather the data in the building to document a sick building, is that what you're...
Yeah, for example, you...
Well-being is not good in the building. You need to bring back a report.
Yeah, if you spend a lot of money renting a space, an office space in a modern building, and your employees are sick, your productivity is not so good, and you have all information of analytics for air conditioning, for elevators that prejudice your people. So
the kind of products Paul, or problems Paul's talking about, where there are actually known problems and nobody's fixing them, that's a tougher nut to crack. But if the owner is doing due diligence and is asking us what is wrong with my building, then I think the folks at this table can do an amazing job of bringing back the necessary information.
A good way to put it, I mean, again, the information, the data exists. It's whether or not the owner, in this case, do they even care? And, you know, and I think, you know, you got to look at the type of owner. Is it a rental type property or lease type property versus owner occupied or corporate type of environment? And, you know, to me, I look at that, that's, I'm a marketing guy. I look at that as a marketing opportunity for me to go to an owner and say, our technology, our services, and whatever, here, if you want to know this, let me know. We'll give you a monthly report as an example. And that way, it keeps them, productivity, they can help drive the productivity, but more importantly is that they're getting their money's worth. They can see value that I'm paying X dollars a month to maintain my building. I guess I look at things as you turn everything into a marketing opportunity, because that's my world is marketing, so.
Pleased with that? Good, okay. Well, I think we've
got.
Oh, you got one more?
Yeah.
Just a couple. Was that your cell phone came in?
No. I swear he didn't touch it.
Yeah. We had you on the side of the room.
I agree with Mark. One of the things that I think that we can help the industry at large is helping tell the story. Because so often facility managers, they really don't know how to articulate the story to the C-suite. They've never done that before. They don't know how to put it together. They don't know what will trigger it. They'll go in and say, I need $100,000 to replace a piece of equipment, but have nothing to back that up with, nothing that relates to what the business is. And I think if a giant leap that we could really take for the client out there, the facility guy that really wants to do a good job, wants to have good lighting, wants to have a good environment, but he really doesn't know how to articulate it and sell it and tell it to the C-suite. So I think if one thing we can do as an industry to help out that is to help them tell their story in an articulate way with good facts and good data.
You know, we sell analytics software, and it finds things, right? And one of the most interesting things we saw occur was facility managers getting excited, saying, I've been telling my boss for a year, but when I showed him data in a uniform format that made sense to the way he charts and looks at financial, he was like, oh, well, we got to take care of that. He goes, I've been telling him for a year. He wouldn't listen because he couldn't communicate it well. And one of the big advantages of analytics isn't just to find the issues. It's to give people a normalized visual way. And we are visual, you know, beings. When you see things, all of a sudden, it means far more than the words or the yapping or I'm tired of listening to Annie. Yeah, I know you got problems. You always want more money, right? You know, but you show it to him. It's like, now it's his problem. You really want your building to run this way? Of course not, right? So that these new tools can help those operators tell their story better.
So it's data, right? It's providing data that's going to drive decision rather than
actionable,
you know,
information.
The right data and the right information.
So it's taking data that the guy looks at on a regular basis, and it's providing meaningful information.
Yeah, meaningful.
So what I would say is, I would say, you know, so back to a personal story. So when I started in the industry again, and I tried to explain to my father-in-law what I did for a living, that was an interesting conversation. So did you ever have that?
Yes.
You explain that? So I said, well, I'm in the HVAC temperature controls business. Oh, you do thermostats. So, you know, you'd eventually say, well, no, kind of. And, you know, their eyes would glaze over and roll into the back of their head, and all of a sudden they would find somebody else to talk to at the cocktail party, right? So today's, you know, cocktail party speech or father-in-law talk about what you do for a living is actually, you know, if I was to tell somebody that I make, you know, a building occupant engagement platform, that would be all of a sudden really interesting, you know? And that's part of what we're doing. If I was saying I'm helping facilities run more efficiently, that's a more interesting. So I think there's something to us as an industry refining, starting to refine our sales pitch, and we're talking to different individuals. We're not talking to just the facility manager. We're talking to the IT department. We're talking to HR. We're talking to different audiences. So we really need to refine, to the gentleman's point over here, we need to refine the sales pitch and really tell the story of what our equipment can do within a facility.
Sorry, everybody's been talking about all this data flowing around so that you can analyze it and tag it so it's self-introducing so that you can analyze it quicker. A long time ago in the 70s, we ran into an issue where there was lots of data around, and the lawyers, I'm a pre-litigation consultant, insurance companies, and this data allowed attorneys to file an indoor air quality, this is a California university, because they thought it saved a lot of energy by putting plastic over the outside air minimum intakes. They saved a lot of energy, and they got sued, and that big data is how they lost. So data security, have you guys, because I could see like what you're talking about, the heating and cooling complaints. If somebody got a hold of that information and found out one or two of your buildings were outside the curve, that's an issue in that industry silo. So when you talk about this, have any of you guys addressed or brought that security question about data silos?
The value of proprietary data, I don't think it's any different, right? Now you have the data, so Mr. Customer, how are you going to protect this data along with anything else? I mean, I don't think we're introducing any new problem here to people, right? The data's there, you refine the data, maybe it would make it easier for somebody, but we're not introducing any new special security problems.
We're not introducing it, but I would agree, I think you'd agree, John, that most firms engaged in handling that data today are not taking it as seriously as perhaps they should.
Yeah. I would agree.
That's
for example, I mean, we treat the data that we get from analytics platforms like John's is treated just with the same processes and procedures as financial transaction or patient healthcare data.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Okay.
And but you got to put that again, that isn't a technology problem. That's a process issue, right? It's an awareness process issue.
And well, that's so what we're talking about.
We've got to get more disciplined. The providers of that service in the industry have to get more disciplined around the process and the rigor.
I've been a big spokesperson around cybersecurity, especially in and around our buildings, for the last 4.5 years. And I am still mystified that our industry really has not taken the cybersecurity of the data, the systems, as I guess serious as the problem opportunities and the risk that are out there. Because at the end of the day, one, it's not my problem, I'm not going to worry about it. Two, whose problem is it? Three is, well, it hasn't happened to me, so I don't really care until it happens to me.
To your target.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So. But I mean, the technologies are out there. You can make this information secure, but you gotta want to
right,
be able to do it.
Which is an added expense.
Exactly. Exactly.
It's coming down though. I mean, all the devices we build now have more memory in them, so the encryption can happen much more easily. And this is another problem that technology will make easier to solve. I think that the data you receive will be more secure over time because it's been encrypted along the way. It won't necessarily have been hacked or added to or so on and so forth. And then it's just a question of can the legal framework keep it from, let's say, bleeding into the wrong hands at the wrong time.
Well, the industry is changing in that there's not going to be a choice in the future. You're going to have to do it. There's stuff going in with, this is a whole different subject matter, sorry, but Sarbanes-Oxley, there's stuff in the House right now going with respect to cyber data protection, especially in and around healthcare and banks and financial institutions, because they seem to be the largest opportunities out there or what hackers are trying to get at. They're starting the Moody's, if you all have heard of Moody's ratings, that's another opportunity where companies, instead of their financial health, will be rated on their cybersecurity health. And all that, you mentioned insurance. Show me, I'm the insurance person, I'm gonna charge you $10 a square foot, but if you're cyber secured, you're not, and you can't print $50 a square foot, what are you gonna do? So the business side is going to catch up with the technology side or the risk side with cybersecurity. It's getting close.
I just think this productivity should always include that component in the conversation.
And you put it in here, thank you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I think that needs to fall into an education piece too, so if somebody would like to write an article on that, that would be great to get up on our site. But no, it's I hadn't really thought as much about that as just went on in this little patter back and forth. Okay, we're over time, but this has been very enjoyable. Is there any quick questions we can answer? And if not, I would like you to join me in thanking these gentlemen for taking from their expensive time to spend it with us.